Let's change it. When you vote for
From afar, a U.S. election probably looks like a nationwide referendum on a couple of candidates. But actually, it's an aggregation of elections held in each of the 50 states. The more populous the state, the more votes it has in what is called the Electoral College.
The Electoral College dates back to the battle over the Constitution, you know, right after the founding of the country and our current form of government, which dates back to 1789. And the Electoral College was a system that I think was kind of designed as essentially some kind of a compromise between some of the bigger states and the smaller populated states. It wasn't a system designed for a world in which essentially everyone could vote personally for president. I think the idea was that the state legislatures would essentially allot the electoral college votes, and they would essentially choose who the president was. And so it wasn't the kind of system that we have now, and yet we still have this kind of, I think, sort of antiquated way of doing this.
Seven states have the fewest number of electoral votes. Three, one for the state's U.S. House of Representatives, and two for the state's U.S. Senators. The District of Columbia gets the minimum three as well. California, New York, Texas, and Florida have the most electoral votes. The popular vote winner in each state typically gets all of the state's electoral votes. The objective? Win enough states to reach 270 electoral votes, a simple majority of the 538 electoral votes available. In 2016, Democrat Hillary Clinton won the popular vote by about 3 million votes, but Republican Donald Trump won the Electoral College by more than 70 electoral votes, flipping six states that voted Democrat in 2012, winning Wisconsin, Michigan, and Pennsylvania by fewer than 80,000 votes. So who are the electors, and how do they elect the president?
All electors.
The candidates themselves will put up a slate of electors. And so there are people who typically, and they could be any number of different people from different walks of life, but they are people who hypothetically, and if the campaign does their job, they're people who should be pretty loyal to their presidential candidates. A lot of states actually bind the electors, meaning that even if they wanted to vote, you know, if they wanted to break against the candidate that they're bound to, they're not allowed to. Not every state binds electors, and you do sometimes have so-called faithless electors.
In 2016, seven electors, two Republicans and five Democrats, broke their pledge to vote for their party's nominee. While that's the highest number in history, it did not change the outcome. Electors meet in December to cast their ballots, which are counted and certified during a joint session of Congress next January.